Bible to the book of Daniel, and we have been going through Daniel chapter 9, and the last few verses of Daniel chapter 9, really, in just these few verses, from 24 to 27, there is encapsulated in there an amazing amount of what we would call prophecy and prophetic teaching and eschatology and everything. It's all really consolidated into those few verses. Last week we were just talking about God sending Gabriel to come and give Daniel some answers. The week before we talked about what Daniel had done. The beginning of chapter 9, Daniel basically, when he was reading the book of Jeremiah, realized there's 70 years, and they're almost done. It's almost ready. Those days are almost up. So instead of going crazy and having some new book published and getting everybody excited about the next new thing, well, God's going to bring the people back, he didn't do that. He went to his knees in prayer. He was interceding for the sins of his people and for his sins. Why? Because he knows that they are deserving of being in Babylonian captivity. They had every warning. They had God sending his own prophets. It was things that God had already said through Moses. And they were getting what God had promised to give them when they went apostate. But God gave a promise through Jeremiah that he's going to bring him back in 70 years. That promise is where that little passage comes from. You know, I have plans for your good and not for your destruction. And most people take that little promise passage and have it on their refrigerator or mirror or something. But it has to do with the promise that God gave Israel, apostate Israel, that he's going to bring him back in 70 years. So now, Daniel is praying about this prophecy and the understanding of this prophecy. There was a previous prophecy that happens 13 years before that, that disturbed Daniel greatly, of chapter 8, verse 27, and I, Daniel, fainted and was sick certain days. Afterward, I rose up and did the king's business. I was astonished at the vision, but none understood it. That was Daniel 8. Why? Well, it was some horrible stuff. Some of it was good, some of it was neat, but there was some really horrible, scary stuff because there is something that's going to happen. After God's people have been returned to the land, there is going to be this horrible person who is going to destroy God's people and destroy temple worship and do horrible things. I mean, God's people are going to have horrible things happen to them. He was very disturbed by this. That was the last time we know that God spoke to Daniel. And so 13 years later, he's reading in the book of Jeremiah, and he understands. Wow, 70 years. It's almost up. Well, this happened in the first year of Darius, son of Azariah, the seed of the Medes. So it's no longer the Babylonian captivity. Now it's the Persians who are in charge. Well, God's going to use Cyrus, who is in charge of the Medo-Persian Empire, to get some Israelites back down to the land to rebuild the temple. But it's going to take some time until Artaxerxes is going to, Longimanus is going to send a edict to send the people back to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. So, I'm saying that because all this connects with Daniel's prayer, and it connects with the answer that God gives. So, I'm going to start reading in verse 20 of Daniel 9, because we're going to cover some of the stuff we talked about last week quickly, but I want to continue because there is a lot of this prophecy that isn't fulfilled. And I had brought this up before when we were in Daniel 2, and when we were in Daniel 7, and when we were in Daniel 8, and I'm bringing it up again now that we're in Daniel 9. There are specific fulfillments that we have seen to our day, historically. But every one of those chapters of prophecy have pieces that have not been fulfilled yet. And I have to say that. So this next piece of information that God reveals to Daniel through his messenger, the angel Gabriel, is going to put some more of the parts together. But not all the parts, because there is still unfulfilled prophecy. And as I said before, prophecy, we can get... I mean, I grew up with this understanding, and it's a decent understanding because it keeps from a lot of harebrained ideas and people just making the Bible say whatever they want it to say and say, see, God promised me this, when it's not there in the context, your imagination came up with it, or some demonic voice said this is what it means, with all the feelings and emotions that go along with that. But what we see in prophecy is pattern. Yes, there is fulfillment, but sometimes that fulfillment isn't the complete fulfillment of everything that was in the prophecy. Sometimes it looks like it's everything that fulfilled that prophecy, except we know from some other prophecy that even though that was fulfilled, there's something yet to be fulfilled because it gets brought up again. Well, wasn't it fulfilled already? Yes, but that was a pattern of another fulfillment. So I just have to say, keep that in mind. It's not A and B. Prophecy fulfillment. Case closed. It is A and B and sometimes C and sometimes D and sometimes E because it is a pattern. And we can see that pattern and we know when the fulfillment happens, God already told us. Well, Daniel has been asking for understanding. Even though it seems pretty cut and dry, 70 years and you get to go home, it wasn't that easy. Okay, starting with verse 20 of Daniel 9. And whilst I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God, yea, whilst I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. At the beginning of thy supplications, the commandment came forth, and I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved, therefore understand the matter and consider the vision. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks, and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Your Father, in Jesus' name, we ask for wisdom from your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Holy Spirit, Spirit of Truth, that you will give us understanding, Lord. We don't want something that is wrong. We don't want something that conflicts with something else that you've already said. We ask you, Lord, you give us understanding and see how these pieces to the prophetic puzzle come together, dear God. We ask you help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. A lot of stuff all crammed together in a couple of verses. Daniel was praying. The moment he started praying, God sent the angel Gabriel, and he's called the man Gabriel. Well, obviously he looked like a man. Well, if somebody shows up who is something that can really only be seen in the spirit, because angels are spirit beings, they're not corporal, they don't have a body, they're spirit, but somehow they're allowed to be visible. If they would show up the way they really look, I don't know that a human being would be able to withstand the sight of them. They're holy. I mean, they always bring fear, and usually what happens with every one of these messengers from God, they have to say, don't be afraid. Because what happens? You've got a direct representative from the holy, righteous God, and he's in your presence, and what happens? The first thing that happens is you realize how big a sinner you really are in the presence of righteousness and holiness, and the first thing you have to say is, don't be afraid. Why? You see something that's holy, and the first thing that comes to your mind is, I'm deserving of damnation, and it's finally coming. I'm deserving of this because I know the sinner I really am. When you finally are face to face with holiness, well, God sends a messenger, and he's going to have to say, don't be afraid. Well, what does Angel Gabriel say to Daniel? You are greatly beloved. That's amazing. Well, how could he be greatly beloved? He's a sinner. Well, because the Messiah is going to come, and he's going to take away his sins. Messiah is going to come, and he's going to take away the sins of Daniel's people, the Jews. Messiah is going to take care of all these things. So it's faith in what is to come. For us, it's faith into what Jesus has already done. And we can look to the cross for the once and for all sacrifice for our sins. It'd be really neat from the moment we got saved that we would be completely holy and righteous forever. But God gives us the Holy Spirit to offer us the power to not sin. And it's right there. We have God's Word. We've got the conviction of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit says that's sin, God calls it sin. You call it sin. And then what do we do with the sin? Well, John tells us in his first epistle, chapter 2, he says, I write these things so you don't sin. But if anyone does sin, we have what? A propitiation with the Father. We have an advocate with the Father. Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the propitiation. Well, we've got one who stands in our defense. That's Jesus Christ. And he is a propitiation. Which means that the idea of propitiation, even though it'll say in some of the translations an atoning sacrifice, that doesn't quite cover it. Some will say expiation. These are all big, neat words. Expiation means he's satisfied. But it's kind of general. Atonement means that those sins have been covered. Either way, God is either satisfied or that sin has been covered. God doesn't see the sin and so reconciliation can take place. But the idea of propitiation is Jesus takes the wrath of God in our place. He got all the punishment that we should have got. John says that he is a propitiation for our sins. Not our sins only, but the sins of the whole world. That means everybody gets to go to heaven now? Well, that's what the universalists will say, but that's not how it works. The only people who get to go to heaven is those people who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ. As Jesus was talking to Nicodemus. And he's talking about that serpent that was put, that brass serpent that was put up on a pole. And whoever looks at that would be saved. Why? Because these people in their rebellion against God in the wilderness were getting punishment from God. They were getting bitten by poisonous snakes. And they were dying. So God brought a remedy. There's the snake. There's sin. It's been put on a pole. Well, Jesus became sin for us, he who knew no sin, and he was put on a cross. So now whoever looks at him, whoever places their faith in Jesus Christ, whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. There was lots of Jews in the wilderness who died of snake bite because they didn't look. They refused to look. Either they tried to fix it their own way, they tried to suck out their own poison with pull themselves up by their own bootstraps, they're trying to do something, right? Whatever it was, they didn't look. They didn't get saved. They were more of the corpses that had to be buried out in the desert. It's really sad. I think Moses' main ministry was probably doing funerals, because that entire generation that came from Egypt, except for two men, Joshua and Caleb, they all died out there. And they all died. We figured it out one time, how many people left Egypt and how many people, you know, would have gone through the Promised Land, and I forget how many. It was over several thousand a day would have had to die. But it probably didn't happen that way, because there was big times, like these people in rebellion and God was killing them with the poisonous snakes. A lot of them died that day. Or when the earth opened up with Kor's rebellion, a lot of them died that day. Or when, you know, there was flames that came from heaven, a lot of them died that day. Or, I mean, there's a lot of different things that there was some major bad things and a lot of people died those days. So some days it was only just a few hundred that got died on the way. 38 years took to kill all those people. It was everybody who was, you know, 18 years and all under who got to go in. Well, they learned from the time they were kids to trust in God. Okay. That's how you get saved. Place your faith in Jesus Christ. You accept what He did on the cross, that He did it on our behalf in place of us. So, Daniel could be called beloved, because Messiah was going to do that. Well, in this prophecy, that's mentioned. Okay, Daniel was praying on behalf of Israel, the people, praying on behalf of Jerusalem, the place. And it said that the angel came, and there's this word in verse 21, Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision in the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly. That's where we get the idea that angels are going to have wings because they fly. But this verse, these words of being able to fly swiftly, also means not dealing with Gabriel flying fast, but deal with Daniel being weak and fainting. It means the same thing. So if it's applied to Gabriel, it doesn't mean Gabriel is fainting. It means he's flying, can understand it flying fast. The other way, it means that because Daniel is fainting as he's praying. Either way, even though our English translation says flying fast, it works both ways in the context, so it's okay. Touch me about the time of the evening oblation. Well, the idea of touching him means he needed to be touched because he was weak. The evening oblation would have been that evening sacrifice that wasn't taking place because there was no temple anymore. But during the time when it would have been done, it was a time of prayer. It was a time when people were dedicating the rest of their evening, you know, saying, okay, Lord, this is what my day has been. And, you know, why? Because evening and morning, the idea is right at the end before evening starts the next day. This is like the end of the day in their way of thinking. Our end of the day way of thinking is, you know, right before we put our head in a pillow. But their way of thinking, evening starts the next day. So evening oblation. This could have been somewhere between 3 and 4 in the afternoon. This is when Gabriel came. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. Well, wasn't that Daniel's spiritual gift? And he was known from that from the time that he first was brought into Babylon? That he had this gift of understanding visions and dreams? Well, where did that come from? It's a supernatural gift. It comes from God. It's not like something you walk around and you can make it happen. Any single supernatural gift that the Holy Spirit manifests himself in our life with is something that comes from Him. It's not like somebody's going to walk around, I got the gift of faith and I can just believe it and make it happen. I got the gift of miracles and I can just believe it and make it happen. I got the gift of healing and I can just believe it and make it happen. Okay, well, then you just show up and start giving me some words of knowledge. Where are they? Unless God gives you something, you got nothing to give. This is the idea of a supernatural gift. It doesn't come from a human being, it comes from God. And a lot of these you know, charismatic services, they're saying, we're going to have a healing service tonight. Well, you're going to make that happen? What if God didn't determine to show up that night? Well, they do what they always do. They grease the wheels. And they have these people who show up. And they, the old folks, and they're, you know, acting all crippled, whatever, you know, and then somebody prays for them and they get up and they're prophesying. And it's a show. It's fake. And why do they do that? Because they don't have something from God to give, so they come up with something that kind of looks like that and feels like that, and you can work up emotions. Very sad. So, spiritual gifts are spiritual gifts. And they are for today. But a whole lot of stuff that people calling that, their craziness and their antics, they're not coming from God because they're making them up. And what's even worse is some people decide, since they can't trust God to give them these spiritual manifestations whenever they want them, they've got someone who they can trust, who is not holy, but it is spirit. And all kinds of stuff happen, and they call it the Holy Spirit. And so there's all these things that are happening up on stage, and people are getting involved with it, and it's throwing down people in the aisles, knocking people over. And is any of that stuff ever shown us in the book of Acts, or in the Bible anywhere, that this is something that the Holy Spirit does? Well, you have to take every single thing that happens, and you have to match it up with spirit, with what the Holy Spirit has already done and already said. You look at it in the Bible, what did God say? You look at it in the book of Acts. Is this what they practiced? You look at it in the epistles. Is there instruction on doing this in the epistles? If it's not there, it's not biblical. Could God do something new? Yeah. But is it drawing attention to Jesus Christ? Is it bringing people to the conviction of their sins? Is it bringing people to repentance? We're there saying, Lord, I surrender. I'm the sinner. Please have mercy on me, the sinner. Lord Jesus, I need what you did on the cross. Please take my sins away. Is it doing that? Or is it getting people really addicted to the next emotional exercise? It's all about the experience, or it's all about them and how good they are and their identity in what they are supposed to be doing. There's all kinds of weird stuff that people are teaching to get people really excited about themselves. Oh, I'm the gift of prophecy. Oh, I'm the gift of teaching. Oh, I'm the gift of exhortation. And they go around being so excited about who they is. Well, how does that bring glory to Jesus Christ? No, it's Christ in us, the hope of glory. It's not me. It's not me. It's Jesus Christ. And however he wants to use any of us is how he's going to do it. And he can use anybody at any time for any reason. And there's a lot of prophecies that are given by people who are not gift of prophecy. And you'll hear it from the sources that you don't want to hear it from. Because it is... They're not over me. They're supposed to do what I tell them to do. Or, this person isn't even walking with the Lord. We got all these reasons why not to hear from God. Well, we've been saying no to him, so God's going to bring us somebody who's really going to have it make a deeper effect. To bring us to repentance. So, Daniel couldn't just make it happen. Got to come from God. So God sent an angel to take that spiritual manifestation of the understanding. It's like a tangible thing that Gabriel brought and gave to Daniel. We don't see things, we just see things physically, but this is spiritual. And so here he got this spiritual download, if you want to call it that, you know. O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. And Daniel was humble and contrite and broken, and he was asking for understanding. This is how we get wisdom. And we're told this in James. If anybody lacks wisdom, just ask. And God wants to give everybody wisdom because He's not going to criticize you for not being wise. He's going to say, I want you to have it. I want you to ask. So when we ask, we have to be there receiving. It's like, I believe you're going to give me wisdom. You're not going to go, well, I know I'm asking for it, but I don't know. You know, I never know for sure if it's going to happen or not. One way or another, blown back and forth. Says, you're not going to get anything that way. And it says, some people ask and don't get because what they are asking for, God knows that they're going to use for their own pleasure. Well, Daniel's not, you know, trying to be somebody special. He wants to know because he's in the Word personally. I need to know. I want to know. And God says, okay, I'll give you this. This is an amazing, we spent a bunch of time on his prayer. It's an amazing, humble prayer. Gives us a really good understanding of prayer. A lot of people are trying to teach New Testament prayer as different from Old Testament prayer. We got the same God. Everything's exactly the same. What they look forward to, we look behind to. Yeah, we go boldly before the throne. That means that we can have freedom of speech, so to speak. We can say whatever we want to say. But it's not like the Mormons who fold their arms like this and demand things that are you know, legally theirs to have. And there's a lot of teaching that tells you that's how you do prayer. Well, then prayer becomes a transaction and it has nothing to do with a relationship with your loving God. Now, when we understand He's God and I am what is created, and not only am I that, I've rebelled against Him. Now you understand, we come to Him with humility. We don't come to Him, oh man, I don't know if it's your will or not, but please, 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 please. No, we can come boldly, we can say what we want to say, we can ask what we want to ask, because we are looking at the fact that anything that would hinder our relationship with God has been fixed on the cross through Jesus Christ. So, Gabriel came, gave him skill and understanding. At the beginning of thy supplications, a command came forth, and I came, and I come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. That's the point where he downloaded it, so to speak. Here it is. He didn't just say, understand. No, he said, consider. So there is part of wisdom is not just, okay, I just want knowledge. I just want a whole head full of stuff. Well, I got books. I got this many books on Daniel alone. Trying to sort through. A lot of it's in agreement because I'm not using stuff from folks who don't believe that the Bible is, you know, inspired. I'm dealing with good guys who are taking it literally. I'm not dealing, I don't read those preterists anymore because they don't have anything to offer me. They might have some good linguistics, they might have some good historical background, but I just don't have time to look at their stuff anymore. It's just burdensome to me. So I've limited what I'm reading. But that's just knowledge. So when I say download, it's not like download. Okay, got to download, great. So what did it do? It just added more stuff to your computer brain. I mean, it's not this. There's a command right here, and he said, therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. How do we take knowledge and turn it into how do we take knowledge and turn it into wisdom? We take what we know, we think about it, we consider those facts, but then we have to start putting shoe leather on it. We take the truth we know and we start walking in it. That's how it works. The opposite takes away our vision. As soon as we are doing what we know is wrong, the devil is there to help us continue to like ourselves in our sin. So what does he do? He gives us rhetoric to help us continue to like ourselves when we know we've done something that's displeasing to God. The moment we have embraced that download, we have pushed aside God's truth and started accepting demonic truth. The moment that happens, we're no longer true north anymore. We're off someplace. We're no longer following what the truth is. We're following what our emotions say. And we start getting led astray. The moment we are being obedient to the truth and walking in the truth and considering the truth, thinking about it, planning our life around it, reorganizing our life around it, letting that be our identity, now we can start taking that truth and turning it into wisdom. Okay, here it comes. Verse 24. All that was introduction. Oh, brother. Verse 24. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. 70 weeks. Okay. That word for weeks, we talked about it last week, is Shavuah, which is sevens. 70 sevens. Well, Daniel was asking for what? The understanding of 70 years from Jeremiah's prophecy. That's what his question was. The answer wasn't the immediate, how is it, when is it we get to go back to our land and your holy mountain and reestablish temple worship. No, he goes from 70 to 70 times 7. Wow. 70 years times 7. Now we're talking about 490 years. 70 weeks, 70 sevens, are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. Okay, now he gives us this list, these infinitives, these six infinitives, to finish transgression. And we talked about that last week. The idea of finishing the transgression. We looked at that word. It's the basis word for rebellion. It's the rebellion. So in other words, it's the apostasy, to finish the apostasy. That's the reason why they're in Babylon, because of the apostasy of the Jews. To finish that, to make an end of sins. Now, to make an end of sins. That's your basic everyday kind of sinning. To make an end of that. Okay? And to make reconciliation for iniquity. Okay? All right. You're going to be reconciled to your God. And to bring in everlasting righteousness. Well, this is like when everything is perfect then. And to seal up the vision and prophecy. And to anoint the most holy. Okay. The transgression, the rebellion, when that's going to be done. Okay, we're going to finish that. Well, we talked about the Hosea passage. He says, when you guys come back from captivity, you're not even going to even say the names of the false gods anymore. They won't even come to mind. That's over. That's when it's finished. When you won't even remember the sin. When your propensity to do what you always like to do that you know was an act of rebellion against the holy God, that doesn't even come to mind. That means that you're going to break the habits of those sinful patterns. I mean, that's bring an end of the rebellion. To make an end of sins, okay? And to make reconciliation for iniquity. Well, when did that happen? Well, all of sin had to be dealt with once and for all. All the sin. Well, that's a sin for Israel and whoever that believes in him. And we are part of those whoevers that may not be Jewish. Reconciliation for iniquity, that's when Jesus became sin for us. Then he who knew no sin. He became the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is the Lamb that was talked about in Isaiah 53, that all the sins and the transgressions were placed upon. To bring in everlasting righteousness. Has that happened yet? You know, in a way of thinking where we are declared righteous because of our faith in Jesus Christ, on an individual basis of whoever's come to faith, but it means far more than that. There's got to be a time when there's everlasting righteousness set in place. Has that happened yet? Hasn't happened yet. And to seal up the vision and prophecy. Has that happened yet? Well, some people say yes. And they will go to the fact of, you know, Book of Revelation, don't add or subtract anything from this book. And they will go to a couple other places and prove that There is no more revelation from God. In one sense, I'm agreeing with them. Because any new revelation from God that has shown up and has been published or been added to the backside of somebody's Bible has been something that's brought conflict into what the Bible has said. Be it all of the doctrines of the Catholic Church, when you got your Catholic Bible and the bottom part tells you how to understand it all, which is not how you would understand it naturally in context, or any other, you know, systematic theology who has added or taken away from what the Bible says, or the Mormons who say, you know, that Moroni showed up and, you know, interpreted these golden tablets or this thing that Joseph Smith bought from some, you know, antiquities dealer or whatever the case may be. There's a special cipher, and through this now you can understand this. I mean, we've got the same thing with these folks who, you know, the folks who are Freemasons, who are writing these prophecy books, who said because of some special cipher that came through the Masonic Lodge and passed down for us, now we can understand certain things of Scripture. Thus you have the harbinger. Isn't that great? Now take it seriously. This is Babylonian religion that has brought itself into the Christian church, into evangelical theology. So then you're going to come up with the blood moons or the Shemitah. You know, even Anne Graham Lotz is promoting the blood moons besides Hagee and some of these other characters. It's ridiculous. You start, as soon as you go down this path, you are picking up something that isn't the Holy Spirit. And when it doesn't happen at the end of 2016, what's going to happen to all these people who were looking forward to something? Well, the same thing that happened in 1884 when the Millerites didn't get Jesus coming back. Well, a lot of people who were dedicated followers of him said, oh, Jesus did come. And there you have Jehovah's Witnesses. And there you have the Seventh-day Adventists. And to this day, the Seventh-day Adventists have an abused form of redemption and because they think, well, that was the day that Jesus brought his blood to the mercy seat in heaven. And they got everything is so confused. And now the rest of their eschatology is going to be confused. At least a lot of the SDAs do believe that Jesus died on the cross for his sins, so they'll be in heaven, even though they're under a lot of legalistic bondage and a lot of misconceptions that don't hold together when you take the Bible literally. If you don't take the Bible literally and you just take it figuratively, anybody can make it say anything they want it to say because you're not going to see what the Bible says in context. You're going to see what you want it to see. Well, you've got this whole concept of theology and now you're going to shove it as a mold over Scripture, and every place that it's in conflict, you now take it in a spiritual way instead of a specific, in-context, wooden literal way and make it mean something else. You wouldn't do that with the newspaper. You wouldn't listen to the news on TV and say, well, it doesn't really mean that, it means something else, because we're not going to take what they're saying literally, we're just going to take it figuratively, and so you could make everyday news say something completely different. Well, that's not the way we live life. But they say, oh, there's, you know, certain literature in the Bible, because of the type it is, which means, you know, Ezekiel and Zechariah and Daniel, parts of Isaiah and Revelation, you know, that's its own form of literature. The same way the Psalms are poetry, this is its own form of literature. So you really cannot take it like in a literal way. Well, the Bible tells us how to take it literally and how to take it figuratively. Because if there's the word like or as, you know you take it figuratively, because the Bible tells us to. If it just says something is, well, that's what it is. Just because there's some kind of crazy-looking animal that doesn't make sense to us, that we've never seen before, doesn't mean it's not literal. Because as I said before, when we are in Daniel chapter 2, we see man's visions of all of the empires of the world. And it's this beautiful man-made edifice of the head of gold and the chest and arms of silver and the middle part of bronze and the legs of iron and so on. But when we see God's vision of it, version of it, from the vision God gave Daniel, these are vicious, nasty, ugly, scary beasts. Because that's how world empires are. They're run by Satan. They're not beautiful. They're not adding to culture. They're tearing people up. They're eating people alive. That's what they really look like. Okay. To make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and bring in everlasting righteousness, and seal up the vision and prophecy. When is that going to happen? Well, we can look it up in 1 Corinthians 13. And I want you to understand it the right way and not the wrong way, because you'll get an understanding of it the wrong way. Okay, starting in verse 12. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is love. Back in verse 8, charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail, whether there be tongues, they shall cease, whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away, for we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away with. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. Verse 12, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity. Well, charity is agape, so it's love. The greatest of these is love. Okay, love never fails. Prophecies, they'll fail. Tongues shall cease. Knowledge shall vanish away. So a lot of people say, well, that's when the Word of God was finally written. The last book of the Bible is the book of Revelation. It was written. Don't add or subtract. See, that's when it was all. That's when all these things cease. Is that what he says? No, what in the context is he talking about? When do these things cease? Well, they're going to cease when we are known. When we shall know even as we are known. That's the context. Well, when is that? When we get our new resurrected body. We will know even as we are known. That's when they cease. Well, when does that happen? What's called the resurrection? It's called the rapture. Those who are dead in Christ rise first, and we who are still here are going to be snatched up together with them in the clouds. John chapter 3, when we see Him, we'll be like Him. When we see Him as He is, we're going to all be changed. Chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, in the twinkling of an eye, we will not all sleep, but we'll all be changed. When we get our resurrected bodies, okay, there is going to be a ceasing of tongues. There is going to be an end of prophecy. There is going to be all these things. Why? Well, he says, and now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity. Faith, hope, and love. Why is agape love greater than faith? Why is it greater than hope? Because faith is believing what God has said, but not living by sight. Hope is expecting what God has promised as though you are living in it right now. When we see Jesus face to face, are we going to need faith? No, because we're going to be living permanently, eternally by sight. Are we going to need hope when we see Jesus face to face? No, because everything we've hoped for, we are seeing with our own eyes. But what about agape? Agape love, charity. Now that goes on. It goes on forever. That's what continues. And all of our actions as they are worked up in us through that agape love. There is going to be a ceasing of and a sealing up of vision and prophecy. When does that happen? When, I already know. The same way as I am known now. there's going to be that time when all visions and prophecies, they've been written, they're just sealed up. It's not necessary anymore. Because we'll know. So I just have to say that a lot of people bring this back because they're so afraid of, you know, some new cult like the Mormons or something coming up with some new book and saying, see, there's the revelation of God. That they're saying, no, all the Bible was finished and nothing new is ever going to be added. Can I say that? It would be nice. But any new prophecy that happens, what do? Paul tells us, don't despise prophecy. Don't despise somebody who is saying God said. But he also says, test all things. If we went the other way to 1 Corinthians 14, Paul tells him, whatever word is said, you have the responsibility as hearers to test it. So in a service, in a worship service, two, maybe three, and that's it. And when God speaks through somebody else, the other one's got to sit down. It's not about one guy grandstanding himself. If somebody's got something, the first one sits down and lets the other one speak. But no more than three. Because he says, you know, when you guys come, you all come with something. Why? Because you want to grandstand your gift. You want to grandstand your knowledge. You want to be... But says God, this, we don't have a God of chaos. We've got a God of order. So if there's going to be somebody who's going to speak in tongues, fine. As long as there is interpreter. If there is no interpreter, he can just speak in tongues by himself. Because it's just speaking. He is just speaking to God. Because it's not edifying anybody. When everybody is together to get... gathered together in a worship service, it is for the edification and the exhortation of everybody who is there. Not for somebody grandstanding their spiritual gift. So you can have spiritual gifts being done in a worship service as long as it's not to draw attention to somebody. As long as it is God showing up and people being blessed by God. Well, what would be the interpretation of a tongue? Well, how do we start the service? We sang some songs. Did a couple of hymns. Did a couple of praise songs. What is that? That is what a tongue would be. Because tongues is not men speaking to men. It's man speaking to God. And what's man going to speak to God about? Praise and worship and thanksgiving. Only it's going to be in a language they don't understand. So when people are going to be singing in tongues or preaching in tongues or whatever, it's not going to be giving people information they don't know. It's going to be something that gives glory to God. So if there is an interpretation, the interpretation is not going to say, God wants you all to know something, because that's not going to be the interpretation of the song, of a tongue. The interpretation of a tongue is going to be something which glorifies God. It's going to be a praise song. It's going to be the words of a hymn. It's going to be something that gives God glory. Because it's from man to God. So I'm saying this, I believe in all the manifestations of the Holy Spirit for today. But I think most of the stuff that people see doesn't come from the Holy Spirit. And you can see the results. If the results would be, as we would see in 1 Corinthians 14, the people who are unbelievers will hear this and see this and go, God is really among you. Is that what's happening? No, people are just excited to go follow the whole new thing of whatever it is that's going across. And it's not something that is in the Bible. If it was something that was biblical, then it would have been done in the book of Acts, and it would have been, we would have had instruction about it in one of Paul's letters or somebody else's letters. So I just have to say that. So, seal up the vision and prophecy. When is that going to happen? After the resurrection. When we are seeing Jesus face to face. None of that's going to be necessary. And I know I'm not in agreement with some people who are really good teachers. Because they're saying, no, when the Bible was finished, then it's all done. God spoke once, and He spoke through Jesus Christ, and it's over. Well, if you're going to take that way of thinking, then there would be no epistles that would be written. Because it was just whatever words that Jesus would have said, and it's done. But because Jesus spoke to John in the book of Revelation, then they squeeze them all together. Now if you're going to take that way of understanding it, you've got to take it to its furthest extent, and you're going to have to throw some of the New Testament out. So I just have to tell you that. These are good guys, but I am not in agreement. I think this is very clear. It's talking to the point where nobody's going to need vision and prophecy because they're seeing it for what it really is. They're seeing Jesus as He really is. And to anoint the most holy. Well, as I said before, the most holy here is Holy of Holies in the Hebrew. Well, the Holy of Holies is what? That's the place where the high priest goes into once a year on the Day of Atonement. Well, to anoint the most holy, which means to anoint the most holy place, to dedicate that most holy place to God alone, to make it holy, to make it separate for His use alone. Well, when is that going to happen? Messiah is going to build His own temple. And that's in the time of the millennium. Which means that happens after Jesus has already destroyed all of Israel's enemies in Armageddon. And then He ascends that victory march up to the top of the Mount of Olives, and it splits in two and water starts gushing out. I mean, everything that we know about what Israel looks like and the world looks like, it's going to be totally different after Armageddon. And it's not just through all of the disasters that come through the hand of God, and as He destroys all of all of Israel's enemies through Armageddon, but it's what happens when He shows up and now makes Jerusalem His capital city. And those who are raised in righteousness, the first resurrection, they're going to reign with Him. And we're going to see a promise to Daniel at the end of chapter 12. He's going to get something from God for all this pain that he's gone through his entire life, dedicating himself to be God's witness in a foreign country. It's the resurrection. Resurrection of the Old Testament saints. It's also going to be the resurrection of all those people who believed and were decapitated during the tribulation. They're all going to reign with Jesus for 1,000 years. Okay. Daniel asked for 70 years. Now he's getting 70 times 7. Okay. Verse 25. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks. And 2 weeks. 7 weeks and 2 weeks. It's separated there. And the street shall be built again and the wall even in troublous times. Okay. We talked about this last week a lot. And we talked about what that means. There is a point in time when there was a command to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. It's not the command it's not the book of Ezra and the command to rebuild the temple. It's talking about Jerusalem itself. Well, that's going to happen in Nehemiah chapter 2. We see that story. So, from that time of that command, now that 70 times 7 starts ticking away. So, 77s, and as we said, a 7 is going to be either a day or a month or a year. Well, it can't be a day, because it would have been, all the stuff would have already been done, just past Daniel's life. Can't be that. Can't be months, because it wouldn't have fulfilled prophecy. So it's got to be years. So 70 weeks. So 70 times 7 years. Weeks of years, in other words. Well, from that command, and then you count up those days, And to come up with those days, it's 483 years, which are each year being 360 days each, because a prophetic year is 360, because it's a solar calendar. It's not, you know, it's based on months. It's 30-day months, basically. Okay, and it ends up to be 173,880 days. Well, we know the exact date of Artaxerxes, Lajumanus' command, and that was March 14th, 445 BC. And then you add all that time up, and remember, 1 BC to 1 AD is a year, not two. And it comes up to be April 16th, AD 32. And that was the triumphal entry. What's that? April 6th? April 6th, right. April 6th, you're right. April 6th. My sister's birthday is April 16th. I'm sorry. April 6th. That was the triumphal entry. Well, those numbers came from Sir Robert Anderson. He figured all these days out, and he figured out how that all worked. Well, there's been a couple other guys, evangelical guys, really good biblical scholars, who have... they're disagreed. Some say 33 AD, some say 31 AD. They're starting from a different starting point, or they're counting the days differently. So what I want to say is, it is not so easy. Now, Sir Robert Anderson was the head of Scotland Yard, and he was not just a history scholar, which he was a genius. So you ever heard of Jack the Ripper? He was the one who solved that crime. So, I mean, this is a real person. And actually, The Coming Prince, the book that he wrote, it was actually brought to British courts. And it was became a legal document of England. They looked into all of his, all the details of all of everything that he did for all of his work to come up with this book. It's amazing. Of course, we're not talking about separation between church and state in England. It's a state church, so you could do stuff like that over there. So anyway, so he did all that work. Other people have done it different ways, and I think the problem is, if you figure it out one way, you end up with a year where Jesus died on Good Friday, and they like that. You do it in another way, and you end up with a year where Jesus died, you know, on a Wednesday. Well, does that make any sense? Well, because it's not Good Friday. Well, didn't Jesus die on Good Friday? Well, if he did, then it's not 3 days and three nights. So, I mean, so there you got people working from the back going towards Daniel's date, or people starting from Daniel's date and working towards Jesus entering in Jerusalem. I just want to say it's not so cut and dried and easy as all it sounds, even though I've been there at messages and they make you add it up and comes up with that, and not that easy. So, all that to say, I talked a little bit about that last week. We do have some other corroborating things in the New Testament that give us some dates. In John 2:20, they tell Jesus at 46 years in building the temple, and we know that the temple started getting built in BC 18 by Herod the Great. So you can count up that period of time. Add 46 days, 46 years to 18 BC, and figure out what year it was that Jesus was talking to them. We also know in Luke 3, verses 1, that it was the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar. And Tiberius Caesar, so we know his when he took reign, when he started ruling. So we have some specific dates, because we know the first Passover then would have been 29 AD. So all that to say, we can figure out a lot of things. Some things are very specific. We can, you know, even though they don't have the same kind of calendar we do, we can figure some of that out. God gave Daniel the time when Jesus was going to be coming into Jerusalem. And when he did, what happened? We know that as Palm Sunday, they were saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And a bunch of people, mostly his followers from Galilee, were proclaiming him to be Messiah. But the Jews in Jerusalem didn't believe in him as Messiah. And it was the Jewish leadership that were saying, you know, "Make your disciples shut up. Don't you know what they're saying?" And Jesus said, if these would keep silent, even the rocks would cry out. And the same thing happened when the children the next day were looking at Jesus and seeing him heal in the temple and saying the same thing. Jesus is not going to make them shut up. But when Jesus entered into Jerusalem, we read this last week, he started weeping. And we get that in the Luke 19 account. He started weeping. Because the Jewish leadership and most of the Jews from Judea did not believe in him as Messiah. And they were not looking for the day that Messiah would enter. The day it came. Regardless of how difficult it was to figure out that date in our way of looking, and how difficult it might have been for them, probably not as difficult, they were no longer looking for Messiah. He came the exact day that God tells them that he was going to come, and he weeps because now the destruction is coming to Jerusalem. That rebuilt city, that beautiful city, it's going to be destroyed because they did not see him in this their day. They didn't get it. They refused to believe. And we know, as we talked about last week, there was a couple of people who had been looking for the consolation of Israel. And when Jesus showed up as a baby being presented in the temple, they knew it was Messiah. And they were saying that to everybody they came into contact with. That was Simeon and that was Anna. Okay, verse 25. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to rebuild, to restore and build Jerusalem unto Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks. Okay, and 62 weeks. And the street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Well, he dies real quick. When he enters in Jerusalem, it's just a few days later, and they're crucifying him. Messiah is cut off. But not for himself. No, he wasn't, the word for cut off is not just to die. It means to die a horrible, gruesome, you know, violent death. And usually because you have committed some crime and you are being cut off by God. You're getting God's judgment. But it wasn't because of anything he did. And it says that right here, but not for himself. And the people of the prince shall come and destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now when did that happen? That's 70 AD. That's like 46 years later or whatever. That's... 70 AD minus 32, whatever. Anyway, Titus Vespasian comes and destroys Jerusalem and the temple. It didn't happen immediately. It wasn't that next week. So, and I'm saying this because we are going to see there's an issue to deal with in prophecy. And I've made this comparison before. If you're coming out of Flagstaff, coming south on I-17, and you come into the valley, and as soon as you see the valley, what do you see? Oh, it looks like there's a mountain range right in the middle of the valley. One mountain. But you keep coming further south on I-17, and what happens? They start being separated from each other. You'll see, you know, North Mountain, and you'll see Shaw Butte, and you'll see Squaw Peak, and finally you'll see Camelback, and then finally you'll see Pavago Buttes. Well, they're all in the valley, but from a distance, it looks like just one mountain. You can't see them separated until you get up close. This is what we're seeing right here. We see the prophecy, and it's all closing together. But from the time Messiah shows up into Jerusalem, and then it's just a couple of days, and Jesus is going to be crucified, and then it's going to be, you know, almost 40 years, and then the city's going to be destroyed. And it says... The people of that prince shall come and destroy the city. Well, who's the people of the prince? Well, that's the Romans. That means that the prince is going to be the one who is in charge of the Roman Empire. But is that prince there? It's the people of the prince. So we're talking about the Roman Empire. And the one who is going to be in charge of the Roman Empire, even though that person doesn't exist yet. Now, in John's epistle, he talks about, and he gives us the name Antichrist. He is going to come, and spirit of Antichrist is here now. But he is to come. The lawless one. And all lawlessness is based on being under the authority of the lawless one. So, it's all squelching together, but as you get closer, you can see the separations. This next one is only going to be 40 years away or so. Okay. The people of the prince. The people who are under the authority of the same one, the Roman Empire, they're going to come and destroy the city and the sanctuary. And the end thereof shall be with a flood. I mean, it's going to be a lot. And unto the end of the war, desolations are determined. Well, now it looks like it's even further, beyond just the destruction of Jerusalem. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Okay, now who are we talking about? Not Messiah the prince, but the people of the prince. So the prince, the one who's in charge of the Roman Empire. Well, as we saw in the statue that Nebuchadnezzar saw, there are going to be two legs, and they're made out of iron. But on the bottom of those two legs are what? There's going to be 2 feet and that have 10 toes. And those are made out of iron and clay. Iron doesn't stick to clay. Iron is strong, but the clay is brittle. The one who's in charge of what is now this new Roman Empire, he is the one who is going to confirm the covenant with many. Well, what's a covenant? It's a treaty. It's a promise. It's some kind of agreement. Some legal agreement. And he's going to confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Well, some people want to say, well, we're talking about Messiah here. Well, Messiah doesn't have any covenant with Israel. We don't see it in Scripture anywhere. So it's not talking about the Jews and Messiah the prince. It's talking about the Jews with the prince of those people, the Roman Empire. And with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week he shall cause sacrifice and oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation. And that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Okay, so now we have gone way beyond the destruction of Jerusalem. And I'm saying that because at the destruction of Jerusalem, there is no historical evidence of any kind of abomination that happened besides just the destruction of the temple. We've got a couple of different historical accounts of the destruction of the temple and destruction of Jerusalem. And in those accounts, there isn't anything like we see with the other abomination and the abomination that causes desolation that is talked about. We talked a little bit about it before with the little horn in this other vision that Daniel had. This horn that comes up and displaces a couple and saying loud blasphemous words, and there's an abomination of desolation. And as we go into 10 and 11 and 12, we're going to talk more about this same character. Well, as we said before, this is Antiochus Epiphanes. This is a ruler that comes from the breakup of, you know, there's this breakup of Alexander the Great's empire into 4 different groups. And the two that interact with Israel is going to be the Seleucids and the Ptolemies. Ptolemies are in Egypt. Seleucids are in, you could say, Syria. Those are the ones that we're dealing with. And we're going to deal with those two ones because those are the ones that are interacting with Israel the most. And those we're going to be dealing with the next few chapters. And it's like specific prophecy of exactly what's going to happen. And we can understand why God would say this to these people, because this is horrible and terrible things. And if they had read it in Daniel, they could say, this is exactly what God says. He's on the throne. He already knew and he told us ahead of time. But the picture of this guy who is the last big king from the Seleucid Empire is Antiochus Epiphanes. I mean, he's proclaiming himself to be God. And on the coinage that they found, he's got the word theos, so it's like God manifested in the flesh is what he's claiming himself to be. I mean, it's very clearly an antichrist type character. And he basically, as we go through, we're going to go through a whole lot more specifics of what he does and how it was prophesied and how it was fulfilled. But this guy and what he did, he put a altar of Zeus as he was trying to force Hellenization in Israel and Zeus worship, basically, instead of worshiping Yahweh, Jehovah God, in the temple. And then they were killing swine, you know, and splattering the pig blood everywhere, so to speak, and desecrating the temple. And then we in the book of Maccabees, we've got the history of the Maccabees, which took back Jerusalem, took back the temple, and reestablished and temple worship and cleansed the temple. Well, the rededication festival, Jesus participated in. We have that in the book of John, Feast of Dedication. We know that is called Hanukkah. So they still celebrate it to this day. That happens when getting rid of Antiochus Epiphanes and bringing back temple worship again. It wasn't all fulfilled there. How can you say it wasn't all fulfilled there? Even though in the next two chapters of Daniel, it's going to be really specific that Antiochus Epiphanes, it can't mean anybody else, it's so specific, it's talking about him. How can you say it's not all fulfilled? Why do you want to take this and throw it into the future that hasn't even happened yet? It's not me. I'm blaming Jesus. So all you got to do is go to Matthew 24. Jesus is the one that brings it up. Matthew 24. Okay. Verse 15 is a specific verse. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand. Let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains, and let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house, and so on. So get out of there immediately. So Jesus is taking it beyond Antiochus Epiphanes, and he says, as spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Now this is in Daniel 9:27. We'll also see it again in Daniel 12:11, the abomination of desolation. A lot of the folks, we call them preterists. They believe the Bible is inspired, but they don't take the Bible and they don't take a futuristic look at prophecy. They'll say, oh, well, this happened by means of one of the emperors, Nero. Did Nero destroy the temple? They'll call him the beast. Nero was the one who had Paul decapitated. He's the one who had Peter and his wife crucified. So they're calling him the beast. But did he put in the temple some abomination or desolation? No, there's no historical evidence of that. Who destroyed the temple? Titus. Who was emperor? The emperor was not him, he was a general. Vespasian was the emperor at this point. So I'm saying it doesn't all fit the way they want it to fit. It doesn't. You can't say it all got fulfilled succinctly. And the other prophecies that talk about what we call the tribulation, they want to put all into the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Because there's a whole bunch of pieces that don't fit. So what do they do with the pieces that don't fit? They don't take it literally. They just take it figuratively and say, well, it doesn't really mean what the words say. It means something else. And we just don't understand, so we're just going to take it figuratively. So I just have to say that because you're going to read a commentary, you're going to hear a pastor preach, and he's going to say it was all done in 70 AD. And Hank Hanegraaff, a lot of people listen to him on the radio. He's one of these characters. R.C. Sproul, You're going to hear him on the radio. You know, these guys are good teachers. They got a lot of good apologetics, but they're preterists, and they don't believe in prophecy. They think it's already done in 70 A.D. They got a lot of stuff that doesn't hold together. Have you ever heard anybody debate these characters? They don't debate. They just say their stated thing. They don't listen to questions. They just say what they said. They're not interacting. They're not looking at Scripture. They're staying by their own specific personal systematic theology, and they won't budge an inch. They won't listen. It's not a debate. It's not a discussion. So anyway, all that to say, it's just wasting time. Jesus talks about this. Now, is there an abomination of desolation on Temple Mount now? Yeah? I mean, you got the Dome of the Rock, and on there it says that, you know, God has no son, and, you know, and Allah is God, and all that. I mean, in the Dome of the Rock, there's an abomination of desolation there. It's quite desolate up there. You know, they got the Muslims in charge of Temple Mount and all that. But is that the temple? No, it's on top. It's on top of all the rubble of what used to be the temple. Where is the temple? You gotta go down 65 feet. Now, they've done some excavations, and they've gone down. And they've found where the western gate was, and so all they gotta do is take a straight line and figure out where the actual Solomon's temple actually was. And so, where the Holy of Holies is, down underground somewhere, they know exactly where it would be. And above that, 65 feet up, is this thing called the Dome of the Spirits. So that's where the Ark of the Covenant would be, the Holy of Holies would be. Only, it's downstairs. You know, six flights down, you know, so, and you can't get there from here. So, anyway, there isn't any temple right now. And Jesus is saying, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. It's gone. It's not there. Now, the original abomination of desolation is Antiochus Epiphanes. Well, that all got taken care of. And they rededicated it. And then you get Herod the Great show up, and he started, as I said before, he started building the temple in 18 BC. And they kept building it. And it didn't get finished until about 64 AD. Just 6 years before it got destroyed by Titus and company. Now I had 6 years of this perfectly finished temple. Isn't that nice? So I don't know what the disciples saw. I mean, it was kind of like Disneyland. It's never done or something. Maybe there was some part of it that still had rebar sticking out. I don't know what it would look like. But it was, they were having worship there. They were doing everything that was commanded them under the law of Moses to do. So is this the only place that talks about this abomination, desolation, talking about by Daniel? No, we got to go again another place. I mean, we can go to Mark 13:14. It talks about that. And Luke 21, verse 20, it talks about that. But it's not as specific. But there is another place, and it's 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Well, this is the Apostle Paul. So we're talking, another over 30 years later from this point when Jesus spoke it. Okay. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting with verse 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, that day of Jesus is at hand. Or in other words, that they missed it. Well, they had people who died, and they were thinking, well, he missed the rapture, they missed the resurrection because he died. He says, don't be listening for somebody who said that it already came or we're in the midst of the tribulation now. Now, the Thessalonians were also dealing with severe persecution. Paul dealt with it. He wasn't there very long before they kicked him out. So he wrote two letters to them. But here he's saying, it didn't come from us. If somebody says that we're in the midst of the Great Tribulation, it's not happening yet. So So don't be soon shaken in mind or troubled. Don't think you missed it. Don't think you missed the rapture. Don't think you're in the middle of the tribulation. This should be said to a lot of people right now who are evangelicals who are, you know, fear-mongering people out there, telling them that we're in the midst of it. And they just, they'll come up with these DVDs or these videos, and some of them are on YouTube, and you can see each year. Each year they come up another one, and they show all this horrible footage of all the various things that looks like different things that Jesus talked about in Matthew 24 of all the birth pains. And they're going through Jesus' statements, and they're showing you all these things. And every year they come up with them, so they convince everybody just by looking at all this dramatic details that we're in the midst of the tribulation. So then what's the matter? Well, everybody's worried about the Antichrist and the Mark of the Beast, and everybody's going crazy. I don't know if I'm afraid I'm going to take, can't use my credit card, or I can't use my RFD card, I can't do all this stuff because I don't want to go to hell for an eternity. I mean, they're fear mongers. Same thing happened in Paul's day. Nothing's changed. So he says, don't be troubled, get all excited. It didn't come from us. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. Now, some Calvinistic futurists are saying, oh, it's not the falling away, it's the taking away. So it's not going to happen until the rapture happens first. But, Calvinists don't believe in apostasy, because once saved, always saved, and you're basically born saved, and there's nothing you can do about it. Or you're born damned, and there's nothing you can do about it. So they're going to have a problem with the word apostasy, because if you're a believer, how can you become an unbeliever? Anyway, I just want to, that's the folks who got a problem, and add this in there. But it's really twisting the Greek and pushing it beyond a normal usage. Because we're talking about a falling away, the way the word is used is someone who is leaving a spouse. And this is a willful choice to go away from. That's not how you would talk about the rapture. It's not something that we willfully do, even though we would love it. I mean, I'll do jumping jacks if that's what it takes, but that's not how you get there. No, we are going to be snatched off of this encroached planet, and chances are there's going to be two angels grabbing a hold of each one of us to take us off. That's how it's going to work. I mean, the whole idea of a rapture is a harpazo, is a grabbing, a snatching. Now, that would be a man who sees his bride and runs over there and grabs her and carries her away. That's how Jesus is going to do it. But it's also to, you see plunder and you go there and grab it and you run with it. You break in a house and you steal and you run away with it. That's how this word is used. So the word harpoon comes from harpazo. Well, what's a harpoon? You get this gigantic spear with grappling hooks on it, and so whatever goes in, you can't pull it back, so you're harpooning a seal, or you're harpooning a whale, and you pull that thing with you after it's gone in there, and you yank it back with you. That's the idea. Well, this is a recon effort. We are God's beloved. We belong to Him. We are His bride. And He's going to send angels to snatch us off. And it's going to be a recon effort, just like all the crazy movies you saw when you were a kid the helicopters coming in and people breaking through enemy lines and shooting around everybody and grabbing the POWs and yanking them on and putting them on the helicopter and taking them off. That's what the angels are going to do. This is a spiritual war that we're in. Okay. We think the rapture is going to be something great. For us, it is. The angels, it's going to be hand-to-hand combat. You're going to need one guy defending off the enemies, and the other guy's grabbing you and taking you to Jesus. That's what's going to happen. Okay. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that reason, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that's what we see. Even in evangelical Christianity, we're seeing people fall away from the faith. Following wacko doctrines that are demonic and just leaving the Bible and following things that aren't true. It's happening everywhere. And we've got a few good men whose ministry it is to call it out, like Dave Hunt, who is now with the Lord, and some of these other folks. It's a horrible ministry to be in. Because everybody hates you because you are stepping on toes, and all these guys who, they had a lot of great emotional response to reading their books and watching their DVDs, and all of a sudden, this guy is teaching false doctrine. You need to stay away. Oh, but that's, I love him. I mean, I feel so close to God when I read his stuff. So they don't, it's not, you know, a prophet's job isn't very pleasant. Okay. Except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Okay, now we're talking about the man of sin, the man of lawlessness, one who doesn't follow God's laws. He says there is no laws. I'm doing what I want to do. Nothing applies to me. The son of perdition. Well, perdition means wastefulness. That's desolation, the desolator, the one who's the son of the desolator. Well, the devil is the one who steals and kills and destroys. There's another one who is a son of perdition. Who else was called that? Judas Iscariot. Because he criticized a lady who was pouring this ointment all over Jesus in worship at his dad's house. And Judas says, why this waste? That could have been sold. It's worth a year's wages. And that money could have been given to the poor. What a waste. No. Anything poured on Jesus in worship is never a waste. Jesus says, you're only going to have me with a short time. You got the poor all day long, forever. You're always going to have the poor. You only got me now. She did what she could. That was her last opportunity to pour herself out with everything that she had. The last opportunity to worship Jesus. Right there while Jesus was still there. She took that opportunity. And Judas says, a waste. Well, Jesus turned the tables and called him the son of perdition. Well, there's one even greater, the one that Judas pictured, and that's Antichrist himself. Verse 4, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God, and that's what we're going to see pictured in Antiochus Epiphanes, the abomination of desolation. Well, he's going to be more important than anything that anybody worships. It's pictured in that image, that golden image that Nebuchadnezzar put up. It's pictured in that edict that Darius had. If anybody asks for anybody from anyone except for you, O king, for 30 days he needs to be thrown into the den of lions. All these things, this is Antichrist kind of stuff. Okay, he sets himself up above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God, sitting in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Okay, he's going to be in the temple of God. That means there's got to be a temple of God. Now, the preterists will say, oh, we're just talking about, you know, the temple, we're just talking about the church, so here's going to be a deceiver in the church. And, of course, the reformers, they were looking at this, well, we're talking about the church. Why? Because they believe in replacement theology, that God rejected Israel, gave all of Israel's promises to the church. And there's a whole lot of weird stuff that's happened because of that. That's not the way the church ever believed it. In the first century and the second century, people believed that God still had a plan for Israel. But through the anti-Semitism that came through the Gnostics, through North Africa, they, you know, already Origen, who was supposed to be this great theologian, he was anti-Semitic, he hated the Jews, he was sure that they were the ones that killed Jesus Christ. No, it was the Romans who did it. Yeah, the Jews handed him over, but they couldn't do anything, the Romans had to do it. Well, he strongly influenced another guy who brought Christianity to become mainstream. That was Augustine. And, you know, Luther was an Augustinian monk. I mean, a lot of this systematic theology from Augustine went right into Luther, and you know, Calvin sucked up all that same Augustinian theology. Yeah, some of it was true. A lot of it was not. The city of God is heresy. Some of it's true, but it's all replacement theology that now every time you look at the name Israel, it's talking about the church. Well, you go look up every time that you see Israel in the Bible and see what it really stands for in context. It never means the church. So how can you go and do that? The Bible doesn't interpret it that way. What gives you right to do it that way? Well, it's Gnostic. It comes from the Gnostics who tried to rewrite who Jesus is. Okay. He's going to sit in the temple of God. Well, in 70 AD, the temple is destroyed. Did he show up in there? In the person of Titus Vespasian? No. The temple was set on fire. They didn't want it destroyed. It got set on fire. They didn't just like break into the temple and start tearing it apart. They didn't start tearing it apart until after it was on fire. Why? Because the whole thing was plated in gold, and as the gold was melting under this intense heat, the gold started melting and getting between these huge, several-ton, rocks that built this temple. So they were pulling that thing apart and chiseling all the gold out. I mean, that stuff was so pure, they could probably just roll it up. They wouldn't have to, chisel it off to take any rock with it. There wasn't an abomination of desolation before the temple was destroyed. The temple got destroyed, desolated, but there wasn't a person who showed up like Antiochus Epiphanes in there. So we're talking about something that hasn't happened yet. Another piece of prophecy that hasn't been fulfilled. So this is the one sitting in the temple of God. We're not talking about someone who is a Christian church leader. We're talking about the temple of God. That's a building where God is being worshipped. It's not there. Well, it's going to have to be there, which means it's going to be rebuilt. Okay, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. So Paul is telling the Thessalonians, this isn't new information, I already told you. Now, Paul, we know, was at least in Thessalonica for a week and a half. So in the small amount of time that he spent teaching those Thessalonians, he talked about prophecy in a week and a half because it's that important. I just have to say that. Rick Warren's wrong. Okay. So then he goes on, and now ye know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And when shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of the coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all powers and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief in the truth, whereunto he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So, anyway, Paul talks about it to come. Paul talks about it to come. So we still have more information yet. And we already spent time there, but I just want to read it real quick. And we'll talk a little bit more about this guy. And we go to the last book of the Bible, Revelation. And we can go to Revelation chapter 13. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads a name of blasphemy. Okay, now we got ten horns, ten toes. There's connections now being made. This is the guy who was being talked about, even in the vision that Nebuchadnezzar saw. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth was the mouth of a lion, and a dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Okay, we're talking about the vision that God gave Daniel. Leopard, that was Greece, remember, with the four wings. His feet were the feet of a bear. Well, that was the Medo-Persian Empire. And the mouth of a lion, that was the Babylonian Empire. So we've got we've got backwards the same characters that Daniel saw. All in one person. So it is the restored Roman Empire, but it is also encompassing every ugly, vicious beast that is coming to destroy humanity for its own pleasure. And the dragon, which is Satan himself, gave him his power and his seat and great authority. So now, for as much as Satan is the ruler, you know, of this world, spirit and power of the air, all that, he gives all this authority to the beast, the Antichrist. This character is going to have everything that Satan is now in charge of. I mean, he's going to be empowered by Satan and given him the authority that Satan's got. And I saw one of his heads, as it were, wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Now, we talked a couple of times of different ways of understanding that. Well, the different heads were the different kingdoms that came up to this point. One of them was wounded, and it was healed. Well, it sounds like the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire is going to come back into existence. Everything that was the kingdom of Rome is going to be all put back together again. So it was healed, and they wandered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast, and who is able to make war with him? Sounds like the way in Psalms, how you worship God. Who is like God? Who is like the Lord? No, they're going to say that for the beast, the Antichrist. And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. Speaking great words, blasphemies. Same thing that is talked about of Antiochus Epiphanes. Well, here is now it's talking about a human being. So we go from a kingdom, the power of Rome, to now the one who is a leader of that. And then he's given authority for 42 months. We already came up with half of a week of years. Well, a week of years is 7 years. What's half of that? 3.5 years. 3.5 times. 30, I mean, three. Yeah, three. Same thing. 3.5 years, 42 months. Okay. And he opened his mouth and blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds, tongues, and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Okay, what does he say? He makes this covenant with the people. But in the middle of that agreement, he breaks it. And that's this time he's talking about. He breaks that covenant. Right now he's going to be nice, nice with Israel. But then 3.5 years after that covenant is made, he is now going to stand in the rebuilt temple and proclaim himself to be God. And everybody is going to be forced to worship him. Everybody, every single nation, doesn't matter who it is, unless they believe in Yahweh Jehovah God. And then they're not going to. It won't go well for them. Why? Because it says right here, it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. The Antichrist is going to be given power to overcome the saints. That means they die. That means they lose. Of course, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. There's going to be, as we went through the book of Revelation, one of those seal judgments is what? The martyrs who are there under the altar, and they're saying, how long, O Lord? And he says, just wait until the rest of your number comes. There's still a whole lot more people to be slain by Antichrist and his forces yet. You're not all here yet. And he did what? He gave them white robes to wear. Why? Because they're not resurrected. They don't have a body. And there's this weird, uncomfortable time when you are there, out of body. And it's like, how long do we have to wait? How long are you going to allow Antichrist to kill people who love you? Because you're not all here yet. Because God has given the Antichrist power to overcome them. That's tough. That's the tough stuff. For as much as that bothers us, it made Daniel sick for months from the previous prophecy in chapter 8. He was sick because of all the stuff that God was going to allow Antiochus Epiphanes to get away with. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is patience and faith of the saints. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake like a dragon. Okay. Looks like a Christian. Looks like a believer. Looks like the lamb. But talks like the dragon. Talks like Satan. We got some of those hanging around today, you know. Can tell by what they say sometimes, even though they might look like Christians. But when they start saying that what God calls sin, it's just something that people struggle with. Or you just need to have patience with them, or just to understand where they're coming from. You are now speaking words of the dragon. Either it's sin or it's not sin. If it's sin, it's sin. There is no gray areas. It's either white or black. It's either dark or light. But people who don't have a love of the truth, but instead love unrighteousness, love those things that God hates, and practice them, well, there's going to be a delusion that God's going to send. And there's going to be this person. And they're going to listen to him. Because they don't want to listen to God. Lord is my shepherd, but I don't want him. I want somebody who will make me feel good about myself and my sin. Well, there's one coming, he'll do that. And that's God's judgment against them. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. This is the PR man for the Antichrist. This is a false prophet. And he doeth great wonders so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by the sword and did live. So this is another thing that picks back up again some older prophecies. And the book of Revelation is all full of Old Testament verses that are prophetic. It takes all those prophecies and puts those pieces together in the puzzle that is going to happen in the last days. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. I mean, right now they've got, you know, at these buildings where I'm taking care of plants, in the elevator lobbies, they've got a big CNN playing. Great big, super big screen, and CNN's on all the time. Why? Because it's watching you watch them. And everybody turns and looks at that screen and looks head on, face on, total. They're identifying themselves every time they look at that screen. And everybody is addicted to TV, so they're going to look straight at that screen and identify themselves. See, I'm at this building at this specific time of the day. Isn't that cool? Going to give life to the beast. They're going to animate it. It's going to be animated. I mean, we're so close right now. Because this thing is going to see whatever's seeing them, and if you don't take the mark of the beast, it's going to tell on you. Whoever doesn't worship the beast, they're going to be told on. Because they're going to see you seeing it. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark on their right hand or their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell, save he that hath the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom, let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 600, 666. So now we're talking about the 666. Isn't that special? It's what everybody gets to have if you want to have a job, if you want to support your family, if you want to be able to go to the grocery store, you better have it or you're going to starve and so is your family. So to be a good dad, you better take the mark of the beast because that's what it means. You got to support your family. It's all about supporting your family. It's all pragmatism. So pragmatists are going to what? They're going to take the mark of the beast and they're going to go to hell. That's what pragmatists are going to do. We got lots of pragmatists in the church right now. The unjustified means it's all about having this big church. They are taking these people who are evangelicals and they're dumbing down their idea of ethics to the point where they're all set up. When the false prophet shows up, all he's got to do is push the button and they're just going to come right in and take the mark of the beast, even though they've been going to church their entire life. Isn't that special? We're really close. Well, the temple isn't there yet. So, everything to build the temple is. They're already training all the priests. They already have practice sessions in slaying animals the Mosaic way. They already know how to do everything. They already have all the parts that are needed for the temple to be rebuilt. What about the Ark of the Covenant? Maybe it's in Ethiopia, like they say. Maybe it's squirreled away in some kind of catacomb underneath Temple Mount, like some other people say. Maybe that big menorah that was taken by Titus Vespasian, because you can see it on the rock. You know, they chiseled out of the rock all the goodies they took out of the temple. On the whole arch, everything, it's all right there. Well, where did he take all this stuff? Where did he take all the stuff that he stole out of the temple? He took it to Rome. Who's in charge of all that stuff right now? The Vatican. The Vatican has the menorah right now that came out of Herod's temple. That was dedicated to God by the priests. They probably got a whole bunch of other stuff too. They don't need to reduplicate anything. What about the Ark of the Covenant? I think Hezekiah had it squirreled away because God already told him it was all coming down. And he's only going to give him 15 years. And he did whatever he could in 15 years so that the people of Jerusalem could withstand a siege and so that, you know, temple worship could be restored once all this goes down. So it probably was squirreled away someplace and, you know, priests aren't going to tell you. Well, don't they need the red heifer? Because you got to burn up the red heifer and take the ashes to cleanse. They've already got it. It's ready to go. They've got all the priestly clothing. They've got everything done. Temple Mount Institute have got everything. They're just waiting for somebody to give them the right to start. Who would give them the right to start? You can't even pray on Temple Mount. You can't have a Bible on Temple Mount. You can't take a scroll. You can't have anything of the Word of God there. Why? Because the Muslims are running it. All you got to do is make an agreement and say, yeah, you can build your temple. Anybody who would politically have the power to allow Israel to rebuild their temple and not allow anybody to attack them, and somebody who would allow temple worship to go on the way it's proscribed to be done in the books of Moses, they're going to think is the power of Messiah. And they will sign on the dotted line with them. Could they build the temple? In 3 years? They could probably do it in a year and a half. Easy. They could do it in a year and a half. Doesn't mean that it would be completed. But an uncompleted temple is where Jesus went. Why? What would completed be? Well, make something which is amazingly beautiful into over-the-top amazingly beautiful gilding the lilies. Until 6 years later it gets destroyed by Vespasian. You know, Titus Vespasian. Anyways, it can happen. So, I don't have to worry about this until, you know, they can... As I was really making a big point of, the idea is we follow the truth that we know. We're obedient to the truth that we know now, and we won't be deceived. If we're not obedient to the truth that we know now, we are already walking in deception that we are choosing, that we are willfully choosing for ourselves. those are the people who are going to be taken advantage of by the false prophet. Because the false prophet is going to come. He's going to look just like a Christian. He's going to look just like somebody who is dedicated to the authority of God's Word. And he's going to be somebody who is going to draw all attention to this leader, the prince, who is the prince, the one in charge of the newly put together Roman Empire. So does that mean that the Pope is the Antichrist? I don't know. He's got a whole lot of more power than the last one did. But the one before him had global influence as well. But this one is a Jesuit, which means he's already pulling the strings with the other people who are the power brokers of the world. I don't know if he is or not. He definitely, I mean, the media loves him. He can't make a mistake. I mean, they're jumping up and down and all excited for every single thing he does and says. It's amazing. There isn't any evangelical leader that's got that kind of Teflon skin. It's amazing. Even though Rick Warren gets really close, you know, I thought that he was going to be the false prophet. But who knows? Pope could be the Antichrist. Rick Warren could be false prophet. Pope could be the false prophet. And somebody who we don't even know, or somebody we know but isn't any big anybody on the political scene yet, could be the. It doesn't matter who it is. There's been lots of people throughout history who could have been the Antichrist, but there was a restrainer restraining. Didn't let it happen. Really, didn't let him happen. I mean, could have been Hitler, could have been Stalin, could have been Napoleon. I mean, it could have been a lot of different people that really, really got close. I mean, Hitler was playing around in Babylon. Napoleon was playing around in Babylon. You know, Saddam Hussein, he was definitely in Babylon. But God said, no, we're restraining it. Doesn't matter how far they got. Doesn't matter how big their gun was. It doesn't make any difference. All of a sudden it stopped. And different political powers showed up. But Jesus gave a warning. When ye see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. And then he told them to flee. Well, this is obviously talking about 70 AD. But, and 70 AD, we don't know of any Christians who died in the destruction of Jerusalem. But we do know of the stories of a lot of Christians who who knew of Jesus' prophecy and left Jerusalem. And they ran for the hills because they knew that this was coming. But this didn't completely fulfill prophecy, which means Jesus is saying, when you see Jerusalem compassed with armies, is Jerusalem going to be circled with armies? Yeah. And we know from other prophecies that the Jews are going to escape to Edom. That's Jordan. Possibly the rock city of Petra. There's been some wealthy businessmen that have squirreled away a bunch of, you know, freeze-dried food and water for them. I mean, they think in that sort of they're going to already help support them, even though it could be years away. Kind of neat. Very hard to get there. Very skinny area to get through and all that. There's catacombs and all these rock-faced buildings. It's really a cool-looking place. If you saw, you know, that Indiana Jones movie, you saw pictures of that. But anyway. It's going to happen again. And it's going to be Antichrist forces that are going to come and try to destroy the Jews. And it's possible that it might happen before what we call Armageddon. There might be a previous battle that could be the Gog-Magog invasion. It wouldn't surprise me, because prophecy is patterned very easily. There could be a Psalm 83 battle followed by a Gog-Magog battle, and then finalized by the Battle of Armageddon. But there's still going to be another battle at the end of the millennium, where Satan is once again released, because he's only going to be bound for 1,000 years, and Jesus Christ is going to rule and reign. We're going to be ruling at his side. But Satan gets released to once again deceive the nations. Why would Jesus allow that to happen? Because there's going to be people who are going to be forced to follow Jesus as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, against their will, because Jesus is on the throne. I mean, in my heart, I think, Lord, if only you would just show up and reign right now and force these guys to do stuff the right way. And then Jesus reminds me, I will. And it's not going to go any better for them. There's going to be these people who are going to resentfully serve Jesus because he's on the throne and there is nothing they can do about it. But so Satan has to be released so that those people who are only resentfully serving Jesus will have the opportunity to rebel against them, and they will all come against Jerusalem, and then Jesus just wipes them out with the word of his mouth, and then Satan gets thrown into the lake of fire where the beast and the false prophet are. They've already been vacationing for 1,000 years in Lago de Fuego. They've already been there, which means they are conscious in perpetual torment of a place that God has made for the devil and his angels. And these two human beings who have been demonically inspired are going to be the first inhabitants there. And then Satan and all the rest of the angels will be in the lake of fire for an eternity, because they're eternal beings, so they're going to get eternal torment. And then all the books are going to be open. There's going to be a great white throne, and Jesus is going to judge all those people that get barfed up out of the dead out of the ocean, and all those that come up out of the graves, and all those that come out of hell in the holding tank of all those people who rebelled against Jesus, the God of the universe, their entire life. And they're going to have to stand before their God and answer. Jesus is going to resurrect their sinful bodies. They're going to get a brand new resurrected body, just like we already will have had. Only they're going to spend that eternity in that resurrected body in the lake of fire, receiving the torment that's due them. Because Jesus will be glorified by their eternal torment, because he's a just God. But he wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. We know they're not going to be saved. There's going to be a lot of people who are going to follow the Antichrist. A lot of people are going to take the mark of the beast. Why? Because it's going to work out for them. It's the only way that things are going to work in this life. It's the only way that you're going to be happy. You're going to have peace. You're going to be able to support your family. But there's a place called the Lake of Fire that they have now chosen to be in for an eternity, because they didn't trust God. Right now, in the age of grace, in the church age, we've got so much wiggle room, because things aren't this strong, and we can do things our own way without taking the mark of the beast. We can do our own pragmatism, and we still might make it to heaven. But if people love the things that God hates and pursue things that are an abomination before him now, why in the world would they want to worship him and serve him for eternity in heaven? If they don't worship him now, just the sincerest act of worship is obedience. If they won't do it now, why would they want to do it for an eternity? That should be proof to their own hearts to show them they really don't want to go to heaven. Because that means being under the authority of holy, righteous Jesus forever. They don't want to be in heaven. They won't like heaven. So it seems like we got a lot of wiggle room in the age of grace. But do we? I just have to say that. That's why we are called to repent. John says, I write these things to you that you don't sin, but if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And he is a propitiation for our sins. And not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Jesus died on a cross for everybody. And because of that, everybody's going to get resurrected. There's going to be a resurrection of the just. That means all the Old Testament saints. That means all the people who decided to follow Jesus at the expense of their life during the tribulation. And it also means us, those people who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ, the church age, who placed their faith in Jesus Christ for salvation now. There is a resurrection, and we're going to have a resurrected body, and we're going to be with Jesus forever. But there's also going to be a resurrection for those people who rebelled against God. That's the worst possible thing that could happen to them, to get a resurrected body. Because they won't be annihilated in hell. They won't just go and just fizzle and burn up and be gone. No, they're going to have a resurrected body that goes on for an eternity. And they're going to spend it in this horrible place that's called the Lake of Fire. Right now we have a place in God's economy where he says, go and make disciples of all people, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded, and I am with you to the very end of the age. I am going to be with you. Make disciples. Get people under the authority of my word. Get people under my authority. Get people to understand that I already paid the price for their sin. Let people understand there is a loving, kind, gracious, merciful God for anybody who comes in repentance to him. Let them know that while there's still time. Lord Jesus, we ask that you help us really be discerning and know what time it is on your prophetic calendar, Lord. And as we see different pressures that are happening to Israel, and we just kind of cringe and wonder, it's like at any moment what's going to happen next. And Lord, you've got your archangel Michael who's protecting Israel even to this day, even when we don't understand, what we don't see. And you've already made promises to Israel for that chunk of property on planet Earth. And you're going to keep all those promises. But you've already said what's going to happen. Some horrible things are going to happen to your chosen people. Lord, open up our eyes to what time it really is. And help us use our time to do what is important to your kingdom, dear Lord. To spread the gospel. To share with every creature what it means to be a human being. What it means to know your Creator. What it means to have a real relationship with him. Lord, help us do what's important to you, dear God, in whatever time that we have left. Lord, there's a period of time, those 3.5 years, or the 7 years from the time that there is that agreement made. When that happens, they're going to know how many days, they're going to know how much time. It's not going to be a mystery. But Lord, you're going to come and receive us unto yourself, and we don't know when that's going to be. And you said that no man knows, not even the Son, only the Father. But you told us that you went away to go prepare a place for us. And because you went away, that means you're coming back to take us to be with you. Lord, we're waiting for that time where we're going to be with you forever. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us so much that you would take our penalty. That you would be punished in our place. That you would be horribly treated so that we could have life. So that we could have that life that only comes from you. That we would have a real relationship and really know the God who created us. Who wants us to call him Father. Who wants that close of a relationship with us. Lord Jesus, thank you for showing us all these things and for saving us. Lord, help us respond by doing those things that give you pleasure every day, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen.